you and to all the learners of PGDSS. This morning, for the next 35 to 40 minutes, I'm going to present a PPT in front of you, share with you from your course MSD 011 block course, which says ecology, economics, and ethics. So this morning our topic is Indian ethos. Now, basically, what we are going to do here is to highlight the features of Indian culture and religions in particular, in which we talk about world religions also. What are the teachings? What are the precepts of the Indian culture and religious ethos in preserving the natural environment? So that is the basic point of this particular presentation. So welcome once again, learners and students. It is not moving. Wait a minute. Just a second. Yeah, let us begin with the introduction that environmental pollution may be traced back to the evolution of Homo sapiens.
Madam,
yeah.
Yeah, you can put full screen.
Okay. Give me
That
a
would be,
second.
that's why it wasn't moving. You just put full screen.
All right.
Adi ko bol do agar if...
Adi is here. He has left.
Adi ko bol do full screen.
Okay. All right. I get your point. I was doing the wrong cursor. Adi again. Right. I'm sorry for this disruption. Environmental pollution may
Abhi
be
tak
traced
nahi hai.
back. Can you see now?
No, full screen nahi hai, full screen nahi hai.
मेरे तरफ से फुल स्क्रीन हो गया डॉक्टर कुमन।
इसमें आपको फुल स्क्रीन आपने उधर रख दिया है, और आपका जो ना स्लाइड में आपने इनेबल एडिटिंग कर लो, और इसमें रनिंग स्लाइड स्लाइड शो में रखो, स्लाइड शो में.
जस्ट गिव अस 2 मिनट्स अगेन. एक्चुअली मेरे तरफ से फुल स्क्रीन.
या इट हैज कम. ओके एग्जैक्टली. या
जस्ट एक सेकंड.
बस
ओके. आई एम सॉरी फॉर द रिपीट अगेन. एनवायरमेंटल पोल्यूशन मे बी ट्रेस्ड बैक टू द एवोल्यूशन ऑफ द होमो सैपियंस. व्हाट इज होमो सैपियंस? दैट इज यू एंड आई, द फर्स्ट मैन और वुमन ऑन अर्थ. And it was realized 2500 years ago during the time of the Greek philosopher Plato. And in the process of metamorphosis of primitive man into a civilized so-called modern man, environment was obviously neglected. So the basic notion is that as we progressed, quote-unquote progressed, we developed ourselves, we neglected, we left the natural environmental resources back, right? So importance was given to science and technology, and hence the entire natural resources were being ignored. That's the main point, resulting in environmental as human civilization, as we have been mentioning in the last 5 minutes. The instinct of protection of environment is inherent among the Indians, which motivated them to lay down certain religious precepts or teachings and rules, and to take corresponding measures in an attempt to protect environment. The significance of environment and environment protection are not new to India. It is traced back at least to 300 BC, that is before Christ. The principles of environmental protection are found in Arthashastra. What is Arthashastra? The book of statecraft, supposed to have been compiled and written by the prime minister of Chandragupta Maurya in the Mauryan Empire, Kautilya or Chanakya. Arthashastra deals with, among many things, the environmental protection and lays down various rules in all angles, minutely, with great detail. Arthashastra provides rules to protect and preserve and improve forests and animal species, protection of wildlife. For example, killing of animals and birds and cutting of trees were forbidden on certain days in particular. And if any harm is caused or pollution is caused in the city, then penalty was prescribed in Arthashastra. As far as cutting of trees or forbidden is concerned, I would like to bring, which is not a part of the PPT as such, but those of you are interested in noting down this point. You know, Indians and communities like those of tribes, tribal population, peasant folk, and fisher folk. In particular, if we can call them the rural folk and the indigenous folk, have been practicing the concept of sacred grove, S-A-C-R-E-D, sacred grove, G-R-O-V-E, sacred grove. What does the concept of sacred grove means? That in their natural habitat in which they are living, whether it's a village or it's, you know, extended villages, there is a season in the whole year, maybe 3 months, 4 months, when you are not supposed to enter the forest. It is sacred. And there is always a shrine or a small temple, which is always built in the middle of a sacred grove. It will be a designated area. And they are not supposed, nobody is allowed to enter the sacred grove in that designated period of time and a designated area, so that there is a regeneration of natural wealth in that particular marked area. So this has been practiced, the concept of sacred grove has been practiced from time and again by many folk communities of India. Now going back to Arthashastra once again, when we were talking about cutting of trees, I referred you to the concept of sacred grove. Now, as far as Arthashastra and the Mauryan period is concerned, 300 BC onwards, that even if the wild animals from forests are seen where people live, they should not be killed or no injury should be inflicted. They can be driven out in order to protect the human society. During the period of great Mauryan emperor Ashok put up pillar edicts and major rock edicts throughout the length and breadth of India up to Afghanistan. His empire stretched, you know, from Magadh, from the entire Bihar, which is now West Bengal also, up to parts of Afghanistan, up to Karnataka in the south, and up to Gujarat in the west. We have large number of major rock edicts and pillar edicts which mention all the laws that Ashok as Mauryan emperor put. Particularly in the fifth pillar edict, it lays down that killing of different species of animals and birds which are harmless, which are of utility, should not be killed and eaten. Now some of the pillar edicts also mentioned that there was a ban on the cutting of animals, peacocks, chickens, etc. on particular days in the royal kitchen. For example, during the fast days, whenever people used to have a festival, they used to fast, and for full moon days, deforestation, for example, was prohibited. The forests maintain ecological balance. We know they are reserve of food. They sustain, the forests sustain cultivation on the hilly areas. And they are the source of products of medicinal plants, the medicines, the Ayurvedic medicines in particular. Now, before we come to great Emperor Chhatrapati Shivaji, I would make an intervention between the Mauryan Ashokan time and the 17th century Maratha power under Shivaji. Let us very briefly, because we will deal the topic I'm going to tell you right now, again in little bit of detail, the Bishnoi culture of Western Rajasthan. Bishnois, I'm going to talk about it in slight detail after a few minutes, were one of the historically documented Bishnoi movement is a people's movement from grassroots level to protect the flora and fauna of desert, third desert of Western Rajasthan, in which they practiced non-killing of animals and no cutting of trees, particularly the khejri trees. and Bishnois were supported by the local states of Bikaner in particular, Jodhpur and Jaisalmer. So the Bishnoi culture came in medieval time between the 15, 16, 17, 18. We have large historical documents, the literature written by the Bishnoi saying how to protect your natural habitat, including regeneration of water, which is a scarce commodity in the Sarat Desert. Now come, let's go to Chhatrapati Shivaji, the Maratha emperor. He also ordered, we are taking a historical perspective that through the centuries we have practiced a ban on destruction of natural wealth, natural resources. So he ordered not to injure animals and plants. Plantations were made by the roadside to help travelers to have rest. Let me tell you that it was this practice of putting plants and trees on the highways, including rest houses for the travelers, was actually begun by great emperor, Mauryan emperor Ashoka. So we can see the Mauryan practice continued till the Maratha time. Shivaji commanded the people to protect forests and preserve the water resources without polluting. Now, despite of all ancient wisdom, what happened? With the development of science and technology, the environment continued to be damaged and ecological balance was obviously disturbed. To control these ecological imbalances and to protect environment, India has developed a form of environmental jurisprudence, which is unique, as we can see in the above slides. Now, please skip. There is a repeat of Arthashastra material and up to Shivaji. Well, now let us begin with the world religion that came from the soil of India. We will also mention Islam and Christianity as well from outside India, which are world religions which are being practiced in India for the last thousands of years. Now, Hinduism is one of the ancient religions on earth, one of the earliest philosophical and religious practices. If cosmology began with help in the Western world, it began, the cosmology began with the Vedas in the East. Both the texts declared water to be the original being of reality. Fire is considered as the life principle in the Rig Veda and defines immortal life in mortals. According to Hindu religion, this is, please note, God and nature are not two different aspects. They are one and the same. The different aspects of nature are worshipped. For example, as we know, Tulsi. I know Tulsi is supposed to be a form of Vishnu. You know, still lot of devout women in particular, they lit a diya, they lit a lamp in front of Tulsi every evening. And trees like people, you have the concept of people, Mahadeva, Shivji, and birds like Garuda. Garuda is supposed to be the vehicle of Vishnu once again. And as well as animals like lion, which is, you know, which is the vehicle of Devi, Devi or goddess Durga. In Hinduism, environmental ethics are a part of religious philosophy right from the Vedic period. In the Rig Veda, the basic elements, the five elements, earth, air, water, fire, and sky or space, provide basis for life. And nobody should destroy or damage these basic five elements. But alas, we can see that we have actually polluted all these five elements, obviously, by now. According to the Indian spiritual tradition, nature does not need to be controlled or transformed or decorated. She needs to be accepted in her entirety as a whole. Vedas considered the five elements of earth, air, water, fire, and space as gods. Because in the Vedic religion, all the elements of nature of earth, air, water, fire, and space were being deified. Gods were made out of these natural elements. The earth is described as the mother goddess. And once again, I would take you before the time of the Vedic. I'll take you back that earth is described as mother goddess. You have all, of course, studied history up to your school level. And the Indus Valley civilization or Harappan civilization has yielded thousands of terracotta figurines of mother goddesses. And it has been conjectured by the historians that these mother goddess figurines were popular divinities which represented or which were equated with mother earth, because there are some tablets or seals of the Harappan period in which there is a very interesting depiction of a tree coming out of the womb of a mother. So childbirth was equated or defined as a tree came out of the womb of earth. So mother goddess concept is equated with earth. So Atharveda, going now back to Atharveda, which is the Vedic period of Atharveda civilization, that earth at times is a mother or father and the product of antariksha or sky. Everything has been and is being and will be created due to earth. Water is the source of all living being and strength of earth or cause of the earth. And we all know that the first living beings, fish, appeared in water in the prehistory of earth or the, you know, the geological history of the earth. Water may also be called jivan, life, which means life, and in Chandogya Upanishad, as it is called as jivan, and considered as Varuna Deva and Ganga Mata. Varun is the water deity, the god of water, Varuna Deva. Air is the source of energy. It is also treated as Vayudevta in Hindu religion. Fire is considered as life principle in Rigveda and may be prayed as Agni Deva or Surya Deva. The forests are rich source of natural energy and act as balancers of ecology, and are held by Vana Devata. We have this concept of Vana Devata. You travel through forest highways, you will get to see small shrines, not only dedicated mostly to the local mother goddesses, the cult of mother goddesses, but as well as to the Vana Devata also, that there is a protecting deity, there is a protecting god or a goddess of a particular forest region. The trees and plants were worshipped as they symbolize the various attributes of God. For example, as we know, lotus flower symbolizes Goddess Lakshmi. Banyan tree is attributed to Brahman. Peepal to Vishnu. Peepal Mahadev concept is also there. Some of us also worship peepal as Mahadev. Then the fig plant is attributed to Rudra, which is the malign form of Shiva. Tree is Vriksha Devata and is called Vriksha Rakshati Rakshitaha. It protects the Vriksha. It protects you. The trees protect you. Varaha and Matsya Purana regarded planting of trees as auspicious activity. And what is very, very interesting, treated one tree equivalent to 10 suns. You know, ours is a patriarchal society. We give more quote unquote importance to a boy or to a son. And in those days of ancient and medieval times, the Puranas talk about that if you plant one tree, and one tree is equivalent to the strength and power of 10 sons. It's really interesting. And those who plant trees will not go to hell, but will attain good life. Atharveda speaks about protection of wildlife and domestic cattle. So Atharveda, which is the last of the Vedas, it does talk about that the wildlife has to be protected, so the domestic cattle has to be protected. The ancient scripture, Chandogya Upanishad, has explained the interrelationship and correlation between human beings and environment. The ancient rishis have revealed, please make a note of what I'm going to read out for you. God sleeps in minerals. So the first thing is what is coming in our philosophy, that the God sleeps in minerals, the natural wealth. He works in animals and thinks in man. I repeat, God sleeps in minerals. So we begin even the concept of God with natural wealth. He works in animals and thinks in man. The earth, after all, is the essence of nature. Water is the essence of earth. Vegetation is the essence of water. Human life is the essence of vegetation. Meditation is the essence of human life. Recitation, essence of balance or harmony, is the existence of human beings in totality. In Atharvaveda, once again, it is stated that whatever I dig out from the earth, let that quickly grow over again. O God, let me not injure that vital heart. So there was a constant feeling among the ancient Indians in particular that that there was a concern that whatever I'm digging out of earth, let that grow very fast, quickly grow, so that it is replenished, regenerated. The principle is similar to the right to life with environmental sustainability. We can see that the modern concept of environmental sustainability lay with us thousands of years ago. The principle of sustainable development is not evolved anything new or recent, but it is an established principle from the Vedic times onwards. Rigveda, Yajurveda, and Samvedas, they always highlight importance of yagna. Now we are coming to the element of fire, Havan or yagna, as we know, that fire purifies, it burns everything, that it helps purifying the atmosphere, it brings purity, and also the quality of water is also highlighted in Atharveda. So, you know, today we are battling with water pollution. So water pollution goes back to the times of Atharveda, and there is a concern for quality of water in that particular literature. Let's come to Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna. What does it tell Arjuna? That I am the essence of water. So Lord Krishna is talking about himself, the God. That I am the essence of water. I am the essence of brightness. I am the light of sun and moon. I am the sound in the ether. I am the heat or temperature. And I am the light in the fire. And prana or life in all creatures. So we keep seeing that the Indian religious literature and practices are full of references to natural elements, to natural environment, the natural environmental resources, and life is always connected to that nature. Krishna says that I am the universe and nature, I am the purifier, I am the sun and rain, and I am the life and death, I am the origin and existence, and I am the maintenance, and also says that I am the people tree among trees, and no wonder that's why we continue to worship people tree, including the urban population. The Smriti literature. Now, what is the Smriti literature? The law books of ancient India in particular. Now, it's very famous, Manu Smriti and Yagavalka Smriti. Still, in legal cases, Smriti literature such as Manusmriti and Yagavalka Smriti, particularly to do with the laws of inheritance, property, land, etc., they are still being quoted in the court of law. Now, Manusmriti and Yagavalka Smriti also stress on the importance of environmental protection. Manusmriti mentions about the optimum use of natural resources. That is one of the principles of sustainable development, not only through Puranas and Vedas, Itihasa, but also through various stories. The Smriti literature and Puranas are the popular storytelling literature. So that the concept of natural environment and sustainability were not only confined to the upper classes or the elite classes, but through this storytelling, it percolated down to each and everybody in the Indian society. So it is all about conserving environment, and it has imbibed the principle of sustainable development. Now coming to Buddhism, now we'll take up Buddhism, Jainism, Christianity, and Islam briefly. Buddhism respects exact norms of ecology. We particularly know that Buddhism has to do a lot with non-violence before we come to Jainism, which is the highest form of practicing, you know, philosophically and religion-wise, Jainism. So the Buddhists are forbidden to cut the trees, to destroy animals, birds, or pollute water. Universal compassion, non-violence, love and service, and mutual protection are the basic attributes of Buddhism. Jain scriptures preach not to injure. You would be, many of you would know that how the Jains are so very particular and strict about preserving beings or life forms. You know, I know of Jain ladies who do not eat after sunset, whatever they eat during the day. That is with the presumption, they believe that if you open your mouth, the microorganisms, the small form of life will enter your mouth and will get destroyed and killed. So they are very strict about preserving life and nature. So Jain scriptures preach not to injure, abuse or oppress, enslave, insult, torment, torture or kill any creature or any living being. And for him, in the heading to the three precepts, right belief, right conduct, and right knowledge is known as Tri Ratna, or the three principles. Lord Mahavira said that nothing was so subtler and smaller than an atom, and so vast than space, and no quality is more subtle than the quality of non-violence, and nothing is more virtuous than reverence for life. As I said, the Jain still practice very strict reverence for life. He profoundly declared that those who neglected the five elements, that is earth, air, sky, and fire, and vegetation, neglected his own sustenance. So sustainability and sustenance were part and parcel of our Indian philosophy, religion, and culture. Sikhism, for a Sikh, to divinity or God lies in nature, and to meet their needs, we need not to over-exploit the nature. Now coming to one of the oldest religions on earth, Zoroastrianism, or the one founded by Zarathustra in ancient Iran or Persia. Zoroastrians are more conscious of nature, not only in their words, but also in their thoughts and deeds. They have reverence towards nature's gifts, that is air, water, earth, fire, sky, animals and plants, among other things. Christianity. The biblical verses in Old and New Testament provide that it is the duty of a man to protect nature and humanity, and we must safeguard or care for the environment. Christianity prescribes a harmonious relationship between man and nature. So we see in all the world religions, there is a reverence for life, reverence for nature, because life is sustained only by nature. The Holy Quran, coming to Islam, the message of unity, harmony, balance, and order represents sustainable development. One should not alter the environment or disrupt the balance. If any such damage is caused to the environment, it is considered a mischief or a facade. The God is owner and man is the guardian of all creatures. And Allah has created nature, thus destruction of nature is injurious to Allah. Islam says that man is the replica of universe, and it's the duty of every man is to safeguard the health of universe. Judaism, what is now in Israel, the Jews are more concerned. Also, they have equal concern for environment. The foundation of Judaism is to safeguard the living creatures. Jews regard humanity as custodian of the world and warn them not to destroy the world. If done, there will be no one to set it right. The fundamental Jewish principle is to preserve, protect, and safeguard the environment. So we see that all the world religions have preached and asked their followers to practice protection and conservation of natural environment because that is the source of life. So in particular, we keep repeating, we keep emphasizing the Hindus have much faith in their spiritual and cultural traditions and principles. And the example of this philosophy, which I mentioned right in the beginning, are Vishnuis and to coming to modern period in the 20th century, the Chipko movement. Here will be a little bit detail of the Vishnuis that I mentioned right in the beginning between Maratha Emperor Shivaji and Arthashastra Emperor Ashoka. Vishnuis are an offshoot of Hinduism founded by Guru Maharaj Jamboji, and he had formed some injunctions, some teachings, some principles, including ban on cutting trees and killing of animals, particularly lot of antelopes and black bucks. They move in the desert areas of Western Rajasthan, the districts of Bikaner, Jodhpur and Jaisalmer in particular. The community used to practice environmental protection as a religious precept, as dharma. And there is this famous, what you can see, soldiers of the king of Jodhpur were sent to Vishnoi Falls to cut wood. I'm going to tell you in a minute time that the Vishnois were a very, very protective. They were very protective of the natural environment because let's not forget one thing. If we are talking about the protection of natural vegetation and animal wealth in the bounty of nature, in the normal natural habitat, you can imagine that every natural resource is a scarcity in the third desert of Western Rajasthan. The districts that I have been repeating the name, they hardly have anything except seasonal rainfall, except seasonal agricultural practices, seasonal migration of cattle wealth, what is called practicing of animal husbandry. And mostly it is the trade, which is the backbone of economy, it has been. But for the villagers of Western Rajasthan, khejri trees have been the backbone or the, as they say, the lifeline of desert and preservation of very limited water resources whenever the seasonal rains come. So what had happened when the Vishnois at their grassroots level started protecting the local flora and fauna, including protection of all, not only cattle well, but all the animals in their thorny desert forest, the soldiers, this is a very, very famous story, and Amrita Devi, a crowd had gathered when the soldiers of Jodhpur state had come and started felling the khejri trees because they wanted to build a road or construct something for some infrastructure activities. Now Amrita Devi called all her villagers, all the brothers and sisters, please come and stop this. They started hugging the trees, and that's how many of them were killed in the process by the soldiers. And once the news reached the royal court, of course, that mass destruction was stopped, and government of Rajasthan has historically accepted that this happened. Amrita Devi led the crowd, and government of India and Ministry of Environment has instituted Amrita Devi Award for protection of local, particularly the animal wealth in Rajasthan. And we have examples, it still continues, that in 2005, 2010, there were martyrs, who fought against the poachers, who came to kill the local animals. They laid down their lives while protecting the local animals. And posthumously, Amrita Devi Award has been given to these Vishnois. So we can see the Vishnois are a living culture of not only of Rajasthan, we have Vishnois in Haryana and parts of Punjab too. So this was an example of kind of a satyagraha for medieval India. And the same Vishnoi movement, hugging the trees, influenced Dr. Sundar Lal Bahuguna. You are all familiar with this name. He received Padma Bhushan, who started the CIPCO movement in 1973. What was this CIPCO movement? What happened? That government went for the construction of ferry dam, in which lot of villages were submerged in the excavation of this huge dam, and the natural resources were all destroyed. The villagers in the beginning of Uttar Pradesh, I will go to the Himalayas within a minute, formed a human chain and protested against the cutting of trees. The same event of protest was followed after 1973 by the villagers in the Himalayas in 1974, forcing contractors not to fell the trees. Since then, the CIPCO movement has developed into an eco-development movement. So you can see the chain of connection between the Bishnois and Dr. Sundar Lal Bahuguna's CIPCO movement. And yet another name I would like to take, Dr. Medha Patkar, who led, a famous environmentalist, who led the protest for environmental protection against the construction of Sardar Sarovar Dam or the Narmada Bachao Andolan. Now coming to Gandhian perspective. Mahatma Gandhi said that environment was the repository of human spirit. He thought of the consequences of industrialization and urbanization. He tried to re-establish Indian culture and ancient tradition, but due to the victory and dance of science and technology, nobody really cared to listen to Mahatma Gandhi. As we know, he initiated the Swadeshi movement as he believed that India's backbone lay in the villages, and if we destroy the village wealth, we are killing the very foundation of India, and we should strive to protect the natural wealth and the villages of India, which are our very survival instinct. Gandhiji's remarkable foresight and ability to go to the root cause of ecological problems said that the need of forests should receive the topmost priority in the development planning. Because what happened with industrialization and urbanization, the entire focus of development came to the city, and the village and villagers became poorer to poorer, right? So he mentioned about the need of the forest, because he believed that that only helped in the sustainable development. Gandhiji stated quite clearly that the greed of a few people and their tendency to pursue a highly affluent and wasteful lifestyle could prove very destructive to nature. This is evident today in the global warming, as we can see what has happened today. Air and water pollution, as I said, we've been battling with water pollution, something even Atharveda talked about, and various other ecological problems. His solution to environmental crisis was all about curbing this greed. And he said, it's a very famous, you know, quotation from Gandhiji, "Earth has enough for everyone, but not for everyone greed." Thus, United Nations also felt the need to have coordination between development and protection of environment, and raised the need for legislative urge or jurisprudence, and we know there have been quite a few art summits. The development leads to industrialization and urbanization, which in turn leads to obvious pollution and environmental degradation. Environment, coming to the current contemporary period, is an all-encompassing term, and there has never been a more appropriate time to consider environmental law than now. Globalization and technological innovations have changed the industrial composition, typically from resource and agricultural-based industries to heavy industries, high-tech manufacturing, etc., which has precipitated a massive environmental change. Let us remember that nature is always tolerant and productive, but the heavy disturbances caused in the ecosystem, including even we know that earthquakes, repeated earthquakes, are also the result of these heavy disturbances, you know, that we have carried out on the surface of Earth. unlimited extraction of natural products made nature intolerable and started showing the consequences of such activities. As a result, man developed concern for protection of environment in the name of environmentalism. As we say that environmentalism, so it is all about our concern for protection of environment. Following is a list of environmental issues which is due to human activity. A, climate change, global warming, fossil fuels, sea level rise, effect of automobile on societies, the air pollution. Those who are living in Delhi, you know the air quality index in this city. Conservation, genetic erosion, Holocene extinction event, invasive species, extinction of species, habitat destruction, habitat fragmentation, pollinator decline, coral bleaching and veiling. Dams, I have already mentioned about the Tehri Dam, the environmental impact of dams. I have already given you the example of the Narmada Bachao Andolan in case of Sardar Sarovar project as well as Tehri Dam and the case of Chipko movement under Sundarlal Bahugunaji. Energy. Energy conservation, renewable energy, efficient energy use, renewable energy, and the issue of commercialization. Genetic engineering, which has led to genetic pollution. Intensive farming has led to overgrazing, issues of irrigation and monoculture. Land degradation, desertification, land pollution, soil erosion, soil contamination, soil conservation, soil salination. Nanotechnology has led to nanotoxicology and nanopollution. Nuclear issues, of course, who doesn't know nuclear power fallout, the plant fallout and the nuclear meltdown. Overpopulation, urban sprawl, particularly the problem of burial sites and excessive consumption of natural resources. Ozone depletion, something which has really bothered us, and the greenhouse effect. Pollution, air pollution, noise, light and thermal pollution, water pollution, water crisis, ocean dumping, oil spills, acid rain, among many such effects. Resource depletion, exploitation of natural resources, environmental effects of fishing, mining, deforestation and illegal mining, which is a problem in contemporary India, illegal mining, including sand mining. Waste disposal incidents, you know, in Delhi, that Delhi University, some projects and the scrap were sold in the Miami, and there was a FIR against some senior professors of chemistry in the department. You know, a few years ago that happened, one of these incidents. Toxins, of course, chlorofluorocarbons, DDT, dioxins, heavy metals, toxic waste, herbicides, pesticides. We are all familiar with the problems of herbicides and pesticides. The vegetables that we cook and eat every day are full of herbicides and pesticides. What is an environmental ethic? It employs the concepts from the entire field of philosophy, especially aesthetics, metaphysics, epistemology, philosophy of science, social and political philosophy. Environmental ethics is a discipline that studies the moral relationship of human beings to and also the value and moral status of the environment and its non-human content cover. The challenge of environmental ethics to anthropocentrism, that is human-centeredness embedded in the traditional Western critical thinking. The early development of the discipline, the connection of deep ecology, environmental ethics and social ecology, the attempt to apply traditional ethical theories, including consequentialism, deontology and virtue ethics, to support contemporary environmental concerns, and the focus of environmental literature on wilderness and possible future development of the discipline. Now we will come to ecocentrism versus anthropocentrism. The approaches of man towards environmental ethics are of two kinds. One is ecocentric approach and the other is anthropocentric or homocentric or man-centric, human-centric. So Ecocentric is all about ecology based perspective approach, whereas anthropocentric is all about the need, and with that the greed also come of a human being. So ecocentric approach is considered to be a broad approach where the environmental quality covers the entire ecosphere. In this approach, nature has to be viewed and respected in unified fashion. Therefore, ecocentric ethics have concern for the whole ecosystem, not anthropocentrism. Ethicists allege that the anthropocentric approach is completely devoid of ethical content because it's all about need and greed of human beings. They believe that this approach in its content and direction is anti-environmental and confined onto the human, only to the human world. Drought, in conclusion, we might highlight the importance of what has actually happened in all these years. Drought, changing weather patterns, the expected burden of caring for environmental refugees, the effects of consumerism and the health decline associated with various forms of pollution continue and have become major problems for human beings themselves and raise crucial issues about environmental justice. At the same time, the continuing destruction of natural environment and the widespread loss of both plant and animal species pose increasing problems for other forms of life on the planet. So we have taken a quick look at concluding and the Indian ethos about environmental protection. With that, we come to an end of this PPT PowerPoint presentation. Thank you so much, learners.